People attended that this life. How many people even know that I mean, this is a brand new life. Her Director of Technology.
And his wife Chelsea knows. Hi, yeah. Chelsea. In Matthews, campus director, for the campus building music, parents for campus. Can you get Amy Matthews now? Okay. Dr. Lawrence Hayes, associate dean and interim chair of ASLIE, student at the university. Dr. Sherry Powell, dean of colleges and chief official financial student for the campus tonight. Dr. Bozeman, ASLIE, college coordinator for the district at the university. Education at East Central University. Peter Bashir, assistant professor in the ASL interpreter program at East Central University. Joanne Hayden, Tommy Dean Boardman, former executive director at KSD's Chair of the Foundation, and her husband Mike. Bill Moore, executive commissioner for the Open Public Hearing at CBU Church. William Carter, interim policy analyst. Anita Dow, Blake Nolan, information coordinator of the CBU Church. Jessica Henry, special resident of the CBU Church. Scott Horn, president of the CBU Charity Foundation. Bill Mountain and his wife, Jennifer Fran, retired teachers. Bill Mountain is currently a member of the KSD Children Foundation Board. Clyde Milner, president of KSD Advisory Board, and his wife, Lori. Colin Gardner, president of the Texas School of Education Association, and president of the Texas College Thank you so much for the conversation. I'm not going to have any beautiful introduction and ASL. Thank you so very much. Thank you for the mayor and all the candidates that are here tonight. Thank you for the support of the education and youth and this community. Thank you all of you for that community, the same community, the teams, all of this community, so much for coming to see and celebrating with that. Charter he has roots in Gallaudet. I claim his Gallaudet first. Abraham Lincoln is ours. But it is very important that Gallaudet is represented in 153 years. But it's unfortunate and wonderful in the same token that we are still the only university in the world where a government supports the right for people to run through sign language and written English. Let me say that again. In 153 years, there is no other government that has invested in working to learn and university according to their own through sign language as visual learners. And that can only sound that commitment, the right to learn for those individuals to receive their education as this country. Set up the first state of the school certificate. Small, right here, with the same principle. We as a public have a duty to set ourselves our founding fathers. And we have Jefferson, Jay, all of them talked about the importance of investing and knowledge into all. The more we invest in knowledge into the people, it protects our democracy. But the things that we have to clarify, we are all here as citizens of this right and amazing country. But with that comes the right to vote, the right to be a part of things, to lead, to guide us in a place such as tonight to celebrate our story. It's fascinating. Now, as we continue to move forward, we have graduates and Gallaudet, and the years go on, and come here to KSD, and we move forward, and the years go back. The people talk about our language, our culture, and our new forward. Then a person shows up. It's interesting that this individual, Gallaudet, knows sign language really well, and then he's teaching. Deaf people look at him and say, sign language is ridiculous. But we have this sign language in this country. It was not recognized as a language, but that is a formal language that would be equivalent to English. Do you guys remember that time? I remember being a little girl. How many of you remember when sign language was forbidden to sign? It was not allowed to be used. We remember. Remember that time. As deaf individuals, when a man came in and said, English language, he said, I'm not going to do that. And he was a man, and he said, there's a pattern there. There's a pattern. And I love that one. When you see a pattern in the steps, and you start to discover that faculty and staff and students, that anyone who wanted this paper, he would write down all day. He would put people signing, he would take notes, and he could write it down until he had so much of it stacked and stacked in it. He published the first paper. It's fascinating. In 1960, not too long ago, that they identified it as a recognized language. Now, English has been recognized as a language for centuries. For 500 years, when they started to print the global press, to help enhance our opportunities to educate these children through public education. And now, languages from other countries have been incorporated for thousands of years, right? We all know those other languages have been recognized. Sign language will only be reach the phone. Right? Or maybe we live in a town that's even right now for the money question. But I look in this room crying today. Because I know that there is not another community that is born and makes this memories like this. We are that collaboration of the world. And we gather together and make discoveries and nothing can stop us. With wealth, 1,500, 2,000 years to recognize our language as a language. In 57, look at what we've accomplished. It's amazing. In 57 short years, we have studied vocabulary, dictionaries. We have come up with fields of linguistics based on American sign language. That American sign language field now has generated a recognition of 120 other sign languages across the world. Let me say that again. In 57 years, from one American sign language being recognized as a language, over 120 different sign languages have been identified in the world. And guess what? I was just in Hungary, just recently. And we think that there are many. Another 170 to 250 languages that haven't even been recognized. We're on a roll. So many languages catching up to the final. But how do we know it's catching up? How do we know these things? First of all, there's more countries out there who are recognizing sign language in their communities as an official language of their country. They actually have stronger sign language rights and recognition in the countries than America itself. They are ahead of us. Can you imagine? So there is no. We have fields of deaf studies, data science studies, history of our people, sociology of our people, psychology of our people. Even though we know that the science of our humanities.
Now wait a minute.
That's the science of our things. Did you know that we are having science to prove our friends as the people we have created, sign language, to communicate, to thrive, to make art, to make theater, to make literature, all of those beautiful things. We have found the science that we do. Milan, the concept of Milan is long. The science we have done proves. And do you know what it says? The science says that for the first time in history of the entire world, that the area of your brain, which is called the auditory part of your brain, the auditory cortex, the ears, right behind your ears, right, must be a spoken language because people can hear. Your brain fires when people are talking. It gives you that stimulation and that auditory input of language, right? We accepted that science for 300 years. That science is language in spoken form as in your auditory language. All children must learn spoken language. And if not, then they will lose that input. Still, the English would be gone, right? That's what we believe. How many of you were taught that? I was taught that. That could only be produced auditorily. Because your auditory cortex is only to your ears. that it was associated with language. But wait a minute. Deaf people came along with their allies. I think many got again and we got together and we made some more discovery. And a lot of them were about university. And what do you think we found? It's amazing. But we have found that women have an exit. Suppose they're hearing and you speak to them. It fires in that auditory cortex of the brain. And when you have a baby, that is a deaf child, it fires as well. Even when you're using sign language, and it fires all the way through your brain. In fact, it's more enhanced and it spreads to other different parts of your brain because it's such a visual language. But when you have an infant that is deaf, and you use sign language, and you bridge it with English, such as reading stories to them, and they can see the pictures and the English words and your signs, that the brain is on fire. That the connections and the powers are shooting off. So overwhelming. And we know that when you have a hearing unit and you speak to them, it's doing the same thing. But there is no visual language attached to it. And so those parts of the brain are not stimulated. The place in the brain that is turned off is not stimulated. There's no visual input. We have real world proof. There's laughing. But there's real world proof of that. My office here, there are people and people. But almost every one of them have to go to Florida Avenue in Washington, D.C. to get to that. We all know when we have a straight called Florida Avenue, which runs straight in front of our gate that most people enter to get into campus, Gallaudet. Deaf and hearing arrives in two lanes, or three, I can't remember how. Is it three lanes? Three. No, two. Four. Two coming in, two coming out. Gotcha. Anyway, okay. Two coming in, two coming out. Which means you can, ideally, sit side by side of a person who's hearing, if you're a deaf individual. And as you pull up on the campus, you wave to the person beside you and wave. You know, those hearing people are straight ahead. And if that person waves at you, usually they're driving forward and they kind of wave or move forward. But if on the flip side, if the hearing person waves to that person right off the bat, probably know who's hearing the deaf. You know that the person on the left is more deaf because of their peripheral vision. Hearing people have access to visuals, like CODAs, children of deaf adults. There's a lot of CODAs in the room that are identified just like deaf. They just have that internal nature, but that peripheral vision is wider. Unlike hearing people who are only used to things, the peripheral is smaller. If you go to a hearing person, more likely they won't see you. But deaf individuals, CODAs, people who are stimulated in that visual part of your brain, can, and you will lose it if you do not use it. And so the beauty of that is not that one is better than another, or one is less than, but instead that our discussion of having to choose one language or another, whether it be spoken or American sign language, is no more. It is now, instead of or, it is me. It is no longer. But instead, you may now make sure that all of our students are stimulated in more than one language at birth. At birth, which is key. That's why baby sign language is so popular. Because it is a part of your brain that everyone possesses that can be developed based on body movement before they can use their vocal skills. So parents are thrilled to be able to connect with their children as they're learning their vocal. It's a dream to bond with your child, right? That's what every parent dreams, to be able to have a connection with your child. Let's do that in sign language. Let's start at 0, 1.5, 2, and 3. You haven't developed those speaking skills quite yet. We have to dream bigger. We have to dream of a life where all of us learn more than one language at a time, that our children are influenced by both languages, they have the opportunity to expose to both of them. And that is important. That is key. Because we, as we get older, as people in this room, what's going to happen is that a lot of us are going to lose our hearing anyway, right? And my saddest day of my work before I came to Gallaudet University was when people came up to me and said, my father and I were very close, and then he stopped calling me on the phone so I could only talk to my mother, and I thought my father was happy with me. And people started to have misunderstandings about their parents' behavior as they started to age, without realizing that parents were withdrawing themselves from certain activities, going out to eat, talking on the phone. They were starting to do those things without a thought of love, but because of communication between the children. If we all have a sign language foundation on our face, we can change the future of all people. We have a lot to offer one another in this world. We can offer our families an enhancement that can serve everyone. And the science of the brain shows that if you start to use sign language at page 0 to page 3, you start to read and write English from age 0 to 3, that when you go into what I really do read things, okay? Whether it's there or not in science, but I do. I've got my phrase. I don't call it auditory cortex, okay? I call it the language cortex, okay? And I'm going to ask some researchers if they'll call it the language cortex now. I don't know what they call it, but I've decided that, and that's what I'm going to call it. So, but it's the language cortex. Did you know that if language is there between 0 and the age of 3, that it stays there forever? That if you acquire language after the age of 3 or 5 even, that it goes into your long-term memory, not into your language cortex. So then what is the difference? If it's in your long-term memory, it means that you have to stimulate that long-term memory. It is not innate. You have to continue to stimulate it, which means that you're more likely to forget it if you don't use it, right? If you don't use it, you lose it. And you can definitely pick it up again in the future. But it's not the same as having it in the making, in that language cortex, firing constantly in the early years of our lives and of our children's lives. So as you leave here tonight, remember, we have to start with urgency to serve all of our children in this country, all of our infants in Kentucky, all of our babies in Danville. They deserve language, and they need it now. Not tomorrow, not in 6 months, when you get a cochlear implant, hearing aid, now. I am not against one form of fashion of auditory implant. I don't qualify for an implant, but I do wear hearing aids in 1 year. I wear hearing aids. No discrimination there. Whatever it takes to serve. Technology gives me access to spoken language, and of that I'm fortunate to be able to access the spoken hearing world. But there's a whole world out there that relies on a visual experience that all of us haven't even begun to show the world the beauty of it. Social media is our best friend, people. Our young people are doing things on social media visually all day long. It is exploding, isn't it? We've got the news, we've got stories, we've got filming of children, films, and teachers, presentations. I love social media, I do. I noticed this room, we've got a lot of older people, but how many young people are under the age of 18? Raise your hand if you're under the age of 18. Raise your hand. I tell the young people here all the time. We have young people here all day long. These people are our future. And our work is a great way to thrive. Our job is to make sure they thrive. Our day is like a sunset. A new day, a possibilities, new research, new findings and discoveries. We can discover things such as language to science and the brain in such a short time, 57 short years, we can find that research. Can you imagine what they're going to do in 10 years? The world is unlimited. Possibilities are endless. You young people, you have a lot of work to do, so you better get over it. We gotta start exercising their brain. I teach that to them all day today, but we have to support them and help them exercise their brain to use the creativity. We need their creativity. We criticize their social media usage. See how about the potential they have for the future that we don't even understand, but they can even see. And one last thing about dreams. When a young child tells you, I want to be an artist, how many of you first want to say, yeah, there's no money there. How many of you want to say, to be honest, right? Be honest with yourself. How many would say, yeah, you can't really make a lot of money there. I like, honestly, thank you, sir, for raising your hand. I want to tell you, people of the future are going to thrive. Those are the creative ones that will thrive. Do not distract from their sneakiness. Creativity. They're coming from a place that you may not even understand. They're serving a town, and our duty is to create different avenues for them to express those creativity, because as they express them in that moment, that's when they become, whether it's a mistake or awkwardness or something strange or odd or unique, that their brain is working to hone in slowly but surely at the distance and find those skills. And what that means for all of you today is that there are a lot of people retiring, there are a lot of people close to retirement, and there are a lot of avenues, a lot of fields out there in this world. In the next 10 or 15 years, these young people will graduate from KSD, and they will have 10 years ahead of them. And 80% of the jobs that we know of today will be non-existent. And that means that jobs that you are, you, well, I could just say you and you, your jobs will be changed and completely different. And only one kind of job. When a child says to you, I want to play a design game. They are going to be controlling the robots and memorizing the factories. They are playing games with robots. They are going to be making the planes. I've seen this a month ago in Washington. They are our future. Their name actually has diamonds. My son, he plays games all the time. And I'm like, in the world, are you able to do that? And he says, you know, every game has a strategy. There's a logic to every single game. When you figure out the logic, you can solve through it. It becomes easy. I have to work hard. I can't get the game. Come on. I have to know the logic. But he was probably 14 or 15 when he told me about strategy and logic of game. So just keep in mind that we as adults cannot forecast the dreams for our young people. We can't even begin to imagine. We can only support and encourage them. That excitement that they have, we can follow them. Keep up with their energy. Foster it. Keep up with them. Don't criticize them. Don't trap them up. Foster their dreams in a world that we don't even understand. It's going to become a very different world for them. And I look forward to what we've done in the last 60 years, up until now, 57 years. And that fostens creating generating new knowledge in a short amount of time that we have had. That's a great tendency. That's the death ray. That's our brilliance. That's the innate hidden skill that we have. That's finally been polished. Thank you. Do we have any questions? Am I back to the Q&A? Changing them because we can truly evaluate what those students know if they can't express themselves in their first language that they use at home. Trans languages is a possible natural ways to express their knowledge in their first language that they use at home. And that's progressive. I think it's going to change education in 50 years. It's not in the way that we see it now. And lastly, we have already seen how American style is just incorporated into other countries because at Gallaudet University, we have graduates coming from other countries and studying abroad and then going back to their home countries. And that is filtering into ASL. And the research has proven that more and more ASL signers are out there. And they're using more American Sign Language signs. But we want to change and respect all those different languages. If you ask a young person, I talked to the young person while I was in New York, I said, what do you think about language? And she said, we're all going to sign one language someday. We're all going to be interconnected one way. And who knows what it will look like? They were very worried about it. And I thought, oh, well, okay. I guess as I have gotten older in my age, I have become more protective of American Sign Language. But youngsters are different now. They're more willing to try different things and new ideas. And I'm not coming off that we can't protect with the future brain. So truly, I don't know. Language is a cool thing. I'm going to try to just keep my answer short. Thought How can I thrive? How can I help this child do? How can we make everything accommodating to them? How can we give them more? How does my wife have the ability to do that? And his wife's reflecting pattern was able to accept that deviation from their life and their own pattern. His couldn't, and he admitted it. It was such an eye-opening story to read, to be able to understand human responses to situations that are not always willful, but instead become willful later. Also, based on what they have experienced in their lives, their world, they understand until that point. Their speaking patterns, their words, their agreements, working, their brain knows all those things, therefore they feel like others have to follow their own. But instead, how do we show and include over time intentional ideas? We have to let people through their experiences as the only way to change the powers in their brain. Sure it is. You guys are very quiet. You must be quiet. You're going to be performing some listening, so I'm trying to. One more question. Anybody else? Well, I used to be a head of the residential schools, but in the last 10 years, since I've been down there for the last 2 years, a third of the residential schools and the other of public schools, private sector, and then a third is by other colleges and universities who aren't satisfied with the experience of the learning coming. So it's really split across the board. But about all time high, the last 2 years straight, our enrollment for freshmen, we are now growing in a different direction. But we're growing because of language. They're coming to our university because they want the experience and exposure to sign language. Whether they are implemented, whether they have hearing aids, we don't see very many students using those aids. Wires connected to their phone, listening to music, you know, their behaviors are interesting, but they are deaf in the other. They have it in them, whether they identify with it or not, and they know that they can, that they're comfortable in themselves. That's why they're still coming, because they're finding themselves at the university. And that's a powerful lesson to me as a president, that they come searching for excellence. And they've been searching for it themselves. The discovery of knowing something's missing and everything got right and being isolated from different events and being the only one and everything they're going to come up until they come to Gallaudet University. And as one young man said, I'm not a lion finally. I'm not the only deaf individual out there. But they can come to a place where he could even sign. He spoke to us through interpreters, but now it's true in sign language being a lion. And he's happy, that's important. I really see a lot of joy in learning. And I see a lot of, hey, that's wrong. And that's instructions. That's what we're supposed to be doing, questioning authority and fighting and answering questions and challenging people like me. It's not always fun, I gotta tell you. It's not always fun, but that's what thrills me. And that is what I care about. So a third is what I know for residential schools. And those kids are going to be the teachers. Okay, thank you so much for having me.